נפשי לאדוני, משמרים לבוקר, שמרים לבוקר. וארבעים יפדוס. והוא יבדס ישראל מכל אבי נסוב. משכיל לדוד ויוסי ומאורס פילו. קוילי אל אדוינו יזוק. קוילי אל אדוינו יסחנון. אשפויך לפניו שיחי, צרוסי לפניו אגיד. ויסתף עלי רוחי, ואתה יודעת הנסיב עושי, בואי רחזו עליך, תמנו פח לי. הבית ימין וריאי, ואין לי מכיר, עובד מנויס ממני, אין דרש לנפשי. זועקתי אליך, אדוני, אמרתי אתה מחסי, חלקי בארץ החיים. הקשיבו אל רינוסי, כי דלוי שמעויד, הצילני מרוי דפי, כי אמצו ממני. הוציאו ממסגר נפשי, לא ידעסס שמחו בי, יחדירו צדיקים, כי סגמו אל אלוהי.
Teire Bucherem, B'nai Teire, the pillars of the world, Hevel Piem, Zugender Eshoinem is still 20 years old. Batsas, G'doyle Rosh Yeshivas, G'doyle Rabunem, was suggested that there should be a kinnis, hesoiris, for bochrim b'nai toira, loim day toira. Due to this shrekliche tragedy that has befallen Klal Yisrael, achusin and akala, and it should be a chis for Yisrael ben Rav Yeshayu Yalevi and Elisheva Basya, Bas Reb Yechiel Ephraim. We all know, Chazal tell us, that no Me'ira happens in the world without a reason. And there are certain Me'iras that happen that they should awaken people. L'mushal thunder, Aymem. Amen, Jel, the Tzitta Dverin. There should be a Shtikal Tzitta. And the same way every Yid and every Bucha and every Yeshivdika person understands that if you let Chodesh Elul pass without the opportunity of being Nesoyer L'Tshiva or different Zmanim in the year, you wasted a Zman that the Boyer Kol Olumim gave us. We're standing here Tach Shiva of such a Shrekliche Zach. It's a Zman that a person has to make a cheshbon haneifish, and a person has to see vus kenach epes besser werden. The Eibishter spoke to me, the Eibishter spoke to you, the Eibishter spoke to all of Klal Yisrael. I want to share with you an Orach Chaim HaKodesh. The Orach Chaim HaKodesh in Pasha Shemini, v'luvash hakoyin michnes eibad. I'll read the Lushan of the Orach Chaim HaKodesh. Omroi midoi bad yizbur al derech omrom ki kol nefesh shahorgim hu imis mi Yisrul. Every nefesh that is killed by a goy, the Eibishter has unbelievable tzara and pain. What does the Eibishter do? The Eibishter is roishai midumoi tziras hanaherig ahibu malbish. The Eibishter draws a picture of that neherig on a malbish. On which malbish? The Eibishter also wears a midday bad. We don't understand what that means. V'mashiach et kimen v'oyso yilboi shyoim nukim beliboi. Could you imagine, Bukharim, the Boyer Kol Olumim puts on a malbish and all those Yidin that were never geharget by Imesu Oilem, how many millions of drawings of tziris of people that are on this malbish? Could you imagine what Yisirim this is for Atata in Himmel when he sees this? This Chus and Kala were killed by Goyim. They made it to that Begid. The Tzira made it to that Begid. Besides his Labadik appearance and siblings were sobbing, unbelievable Tsar. The Shechina weint. The Orach Chaim goes Bariches and he says in a kidda, Gam Yirmes Elu Achdis Shehem Neherugim. Sometimes Vet men ebach geharget ba'achdis together, Hashem Yirachem. But we know everything that there is that causes the Beshef of pain, there has to be something that causes him unbelievable nachas riach. There's always two sides. There's two sides to the coin. So the Sar Shulam, the first Belzeruv, brings a psikta. And he says in Parshas Tazria, B'yoyim hashmini yimol besara lusoy, and he asks, V'kim du'aran hilchas mila. So he brings a psikta bochrim. The psikta says as follows, before each and every one of us was born, before our neshumas came down on this world, the Eibishter went to us, we were tachas kisei hakuvud, and the Eibishter said, I want you to go down of deim velt. Why do I want you to go down of deim velt? The Eibishter takes us to Gan Eden hu Elyon, Meilichen es haneshume le Gan Eden hu Elyon, Emarim lo hatanigim sheyeshnan shom. And we all told the Bashefer, Bashefer, don't be angry, we don't want to go down. Why don't we want to go down? Maybe I won't make it to Gan Eden. Maybe I'll zindik, maybe I won't be Rui. So the Eibishter goes and is a chmeschanen to us. Do you hear? The Eibishter is a chmeschanen to each and every one of us. Vos moisifim laharis laoiris el yoinim sheudam yuchel lezakos bezehoilim. You know to what madraiga you could reach if you go down of deim velt? You could grow. There's a luna dechaya, there's mitzvahs. We told the Bashefer, Bashefer, we don't trust ourselves. We're not going down. The Eibishter shows us Shesuloi Sese, then he shows us Ramach Esse. This is a whole thing. And we're not masking. Until the Eibishter says, Timirat Toive. A Forgive a bissel blit. Do something that will cause you pain, that you will grow through this and the salivarin. Forget mitzvahs, forget schar, mesiris nefesh. And we will mask him to go down. Kimtos lefi apsikta, that there is another dam that gives the Eibish the unbelievable nachas riach. That is when a yid is moise nefesh. Moise nefesh doesn't have to mean that you walk into the gas chambers in Auschwitz. Moise nefesh means when a yid, when the bucha tries to become nesala, and things that he's struggling with, and those things he tries and he works harder and harder, and he gives up from gewisse bakfeimlichkeiten that are pulling him down in avdus Hashem. Bucharim, that is what gives our taten himmel nachas riach. Yes, he puts on one beged that has nebuch the tzira of all the neherugim, but he has another collage of nachas riach from our mesiris nefesh. That's why we're here tonight speaking to Bucharim b'nai Torah. In this dar, the gresta mesiris nefesh ken zana yeshiva Bucharim. There's a big world out there that's schlepping us. And we say, no, Umar Abaya, Umar Ruva, Mesechtes Ksibas, Mesechtes Gittin, another hour. I'm not going to talk in Besmedes, Shmir Sanaim, Shmir Solution. And the koiches for a bucha, oyim v'noire. And when a bucha withstands that, that's Mesiris Nefesh, that gives the Eibush the Nachas Riach. If we want to do a toiva for this neshuma, if we want to give them Eibush Nanachuma, give him another Mesiris Nefesh, another dam of Nachas Riach, a dam of his Alice. We're going to be Zoicha, we're going to hear from Rabunim, Gedoyli Yisruel, and then we are going to hear from Rabbi Yishaya Zazangazin, Daibish Zalem Gabin Koyach. Daibish Zal Helfen, that we should be Zoicha to bring a Nachas Riach for the Beshefer, a toive for these two tire heilig in the shumas, a nechuma for the family, and a chizik and a hisoreris for us yeshiva bukhrim b'nai toire di b'chol asar v'asar.
Just began the program with Amiras Tillim. But the same is Soyrus, like we say Tillim in an Ace Tzorah. But always in an Ace Tzorah we say Tillim in order that HaKadosh Baruch Hu should have Rachmanis and not allow the Gzeirah to happen. Someone is very sick. We say Tillim that Ula Yachos, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Ula Yerachem, and the person will have a refuah. Other tzoras, wars, sakonis and klal Yisrael, goyim, dangers. We daven to the Ribbono Shel Olam, whether it's for a yachid, whether it's for a tzibur. We daven, please, Ribbono Shel Olam, don't allow the gzeirah, don't allow this danger to be fulfilled. Have rachmanis, it shouldn't happen. But Baba Yisrael Arabim, this earthquake, this thunderous earthquake that has befallen us, has happened. Yedidim, all of us, it's happened. Emol has happened. We've been following this the entire week. Nepach, the Yom Tif has been so tzishtert for so many thousands. What are we davening for? What are we begging for in the Tillim? And we must understand that. Was betnen by the Eibishter. So besides that we want that this incredible curtain that comes on this week's Parsha, Parsha Shmini, this carbon which came during these weeks where we lay in Parsha Shmini, the Chanukah's Beis Amishkan, the V'nikdash B'chvoidi Noir Elokim M'kudoshecha, the Mikdoshecha, Al-Tikri Mikdoshecha, L'mikudoshecha, like Rashi writes in this week's Parsha, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu does Midas Adin, and especially as such a Midas Adin, beyond any comprehension, in the scope, and how public, and how everybody knows about it, because everybody loves these Heilige Mishpachas. Everybody loves these Heilige Niftarim, Anehovim ve'aniimim b'chayeyem uv'moysam lo'y nifradu. But what are we davening for? So Pashtis, this Charoy Naf on Klal Yisrael, which expressed itself in such a, if we're allowed to use the word, in such a seemingly horrendous way, we beg the Ribbono Shel Olam, Yashuv Abcha, Shelenoisiv Ledava Oid. How much could we take? How much could Klal Yisrael bear? Send us your Yeshua, your permanent Yeshua. Bring us to our tachlis. And that's the first thing we're davening for. That all the Yisurim and all the tzaras end with this tzara, they should be the final oila. L'reach nichoyach shbiyala l'rotza l'fnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But there's a deep meaning in the Tillim. This year, and I was saying Yisker on Shabbos, so I had a siddur that a grandchild of the Groisa Mashgiach of Ponovich Rav Chaskel gave out that he brought from Rav Chaskel's letters and Sforim and so many things that he, and he put it on the Seder of the Tefillah. And Rav Chaskel is brought down in one of his Sforim, when we do Yisker and we daven for the Mason, and we daven for people that are not living anymore, and we're davening for them in the other world. So Rav Chaskel, we think davening for a Choyle, davening for someone here who's in an Olam Hazeh danger, that's what we daven for. But if Chas v'Shalom, someone's not here with us anymore, what's there to daven? So Dr. Chatzkel, now is the time to daven. Someone who hasn't had the opportunity, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Ba'avoy Neiseinu, didn't grant them the opportunity to fulfill their aspirations, to fulfill their goals, to make a difference in Klal Yisrael, to be Makariv Yidin, to learn, and to be a Ezer Kenegdoi of a Ben Torah in Koilo, and afterwards to go on and be a Mashpia, and all those aspirations HaKadosh Baruch Hu decided not to grant. So that Neshama is an Olam Haba, and coming before the Bez Neshamayla, not having all these years of preparation, we daven for the neshama. We daven for these heilige neshamos that the Kedusha and the purity which they have experienced in Beinonim LaMokim and Beinonim LaChaveroi, that they've shown us in their very short lives, HaKadosh Baruch Hu should count it Ki'ilu, they lived long, fulfilled lives, and bring them to their Tikkun HaAmiti in Olam Haba. And that's something really to daven for. And the Chatzkel says that's the meaning of davening for Niftarim. And I reminded myself that many, many years ago I heard from Rav Gifter that tells the Rosh Yeshiva Zichrono Livracha that he remembered as a young bacher learning in Telz in Europe with the Greiser Rebbe Elchanan, our Rebbe Rebbe Elchanan, that we learn his Svarim HaKdoshim. Who in this room hasn't learned a Rebbe Elchanan as Rebbe hasn't taught him a Rebbe Elchanan? So Rebbe Elchanan lost a brother-in-law in Telz, it was Nifter, and the Levaya was on a Friday afternoon. And Rebbe Elchanan stayed already for Shabbos. And right the Yitzias HaShabbos, they were about to start Ma'ariv in the Beis HaAvel. And Rebbe Elchanan said, before they start Ma'ariv, he wants to say a kapitel Tillim. And he said he wants to say kapitel Tillim for his brother-in-law. That right now he's beginning his journey in Shemayim to his right place. And let us say Tillim together. That journey in Shemayim should be with Siyata Dishmaya, with Chaim V'Chesed of the Eibishter. So that the Heilige Neftarim find their Gevaldike place and by the Kisei HaKavod of the Ribbono Shel Olam. That's the Tillim. But Rabbeisai, I want to go a little bit further. We're bewildered. We would love to do something, to do our best for the schus of these Heilige Neshamas. It was a Seder Limud yesterday that such an incredible Loilam gathers on a Bein Hazmanim day, crowds in, epis to be noisa ba'oil, and hear something elevating. But these are short things and transient things. Noisa ba'oil with these Heilige Neftarim would mean we just witnessed the Charoi Naf of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that two people that just made a commitment days before to embark together on a life of Torah, on a life of mitzvahs, to partner a life of Kiddush Hashem. And Bavoinos of Klal Yisrael, the Ribbono Shel Olam didn't grant that to them. For whatever reason, we don't know. We're only going to know when Mashiach comes. But that's the reality we're facing. And that's what we're watching. Isn't this a moment to wake up to such a simple reality? This doesn't make sense if the way we look at our existence in this world is an end unto itself. If we live in this world for the enjoyments, for the thrills, oh, of course, we're going to do mitzvahs. We're going to refrain from averus. We're even going to learn and grow in shteig. But ultimately, where is the adrenaline of a young person unless he really works on himself? Olam hazeh. I need any new thing that's out there, any new way of experiencing Olam hazeh that's available. Who's willing to forego it? Because before we realize and before we grow and before we shteig, our perspective of Olam Hazeh is that's the Olam. Afterwards, there's report cards. If you get a good report card, afterwards you get a good prize. Chas v'shalom, you have a bad report card, afterwards toignisht. Oh, but this is the world. No, that's the world. The world is where they are now. The Olam of Emes. The Olam of Netzach. The Olam of Neshamos. This world is where we have an opportunity to prepare ourselves for that world. All the nourishkeit that we're so consumed with, whether they're kosher or rachmana litzlan, not kosher, whether they're b'shus ha-Torah or they're shaloi b'shus ha-Torah. But that's for sure not the tachlis. The first perek in the Mesilas Yesharim establishes a person has to sort out what's a passageway and what's the palace. The Olam Hazeh is a prize door. It's a long prize door. And we always daven it should be a comfortable prize door. We want to travel first class, gesundheit, but don't forget you're traveling. Where are you traveling? To your traklin, to your palace, to your place in Olam Haba. And if we don't internalize that, then this, everything, well, such a story has no way one could grasp it, even in the most minute way. But if we fashtay, there's a world of netzach. There's a world of endless joy, of endless bliss and happiness. Tachas kamfei ashchina. B'malois g'doyshim u'toyrim k'zoyar arokiya mazirim. And ech, in this world, it's echad amarbe ve'echad amamit, whatever the Ribbono shel Olam has for a person. And if there was a chosin and a kala that the Ribbono shel Olam orchestrates, he's the only one that orchestrates. Ein oid no vadoi. That this young couple commit together to a life of Avodas Hashem, and then the Malach HaMavis is sent to snuff out these halakha lives. That means, let's chap, let's get it. Let's wake up and see that we're living a mistake. Everyone, whether you're a struggling bacher, whether you're a chashav bacher, everyone lives ultimately without the clarity of the Mesilas Yesharim's first peirik. This is not where it's at. There is somewhere long and endless where it's at. This is where we could get to where it's at. Of course we daven to the Eibishter to make the journey easy, to make the journey geshmak, to make the journey palatable, to make the journey doable, but it's a journey. Ki hoylech adam, Koheleth says. From a day a person's born, he's hoylech. To where, zokt Koheleth? El beis oylamoy. Way down, the beis oylamoy. We all daven for arichus yamin. We all beg for Avichus Yom and Vishonim, and we're allowed to. But we can't forget. We must wake up and understand the balance. Olam Hazeh versus Olam Haba. There's no better time in our lives for this wake-up call than this, if you're allowed to use the word, catastrophe that's befallen all of us. I was sitting in one of the Bote Avelim earlier in the week. The parents, they were just thinking out loud, what was the point? What did Hashem have in mind? Chasm, a kala, commit to each other, and then don't have a chance even to have any life together. I was speechless. How do you answer such a question? Who knows? Not Darkei Hashem, Anhagas HaBoyer. For some reason, the Ribbono Shel Olam put in my head an image of a levaya of a great gadol that I was by approximately 48 years ago. There was a mashgiach in Beis Medrash Elyon in Muncie when Beis Medrash Elyon was together with Beis Medrash Kavoya, the two mother yeshivas of America. And his name was Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Kaplan. He was a son-in-law of the great mashgiach of Mir, Rabbi Yeruchim Lvovitz. And at the Levaya, the Rosh Hashiva of Ponovich, Reb David Pavarsky, who was a very close Talmud of Rabbi Yeruchim and a very close friend and mechutin of this Rabbi Yisrael Chaim, was reminiscing about the time Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Kaplan became a chassan with the daughter of Rabbi Yeruchim. And Reb David Pavarsky was saying, I think that this Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Kaplan wasn't even a Talmud of Mir Yeshiva. I think it was a Talmud in the Chofetz Chaim's Yeshiva. And when he became a chassan, and when the Yeruchim handpicked him from all the Talmidei Chachamim in the Mir, the whole next generation of Rosh Hashivas and Marbitzei Torah, that they're the ones who rebuilt Torah post-war, all were in the Mir Yeshiva at that time. And people were wondering, why this Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Kaplan, who wasn't a member of Mir, was chosen for a son-in-law over everyone else. This is what Rabbi David Pavarsky was saying at the Levaya. And he answered, someone must have asked that to Rabbi Yeruchim. And Rabbi Yeruchim answered in Yiddish, I'm not looking for a son-in-law or for a husband for my daughter for this world. I'm looking for a son-in-law and a husband for my daughter for Netzach Netzachim, for the other world. And in that, he said, in that measurement of a son-in-law, a husband for my daughter, forever and ever in Olam HaNitzchi, I found him more than anyone else. And as soon as that story came out of my mouth, I saw a light go off by these Heiliger parents. They got it in their way. How could I understand what they're getting? But they got it. Hashem sent them a chassan to their daughter for Yeneveld. Because it's only for Yeneveld. It's only a shidduch where two people committed each other, but their commitment is only in b'moysom lo nefradu. But b'moysom is not an end. B'moysom is a netzach. It's a beginning. It's an eternity. And it's really where life is at. And if we're not going to learn anything else from this noyredike earthquake, tornado, volcano, just to reassess, where do we stand in this question? What's Olam HaZeh's role in a person, in a Yid's life? And what's Olam HaBa's role in that life? Is Olam HaZeh the life? And Olam HaBa is exam time? Or Olam HaBa is the life? And Olam HaZeh is the preparation for that life. It should be long for all of us. It should be healthy for all of us. But let us not forget that if any other lesson isn't clear in this horrendous happening. It's clear to anybody just opening their eyes or thinking for a minute. This world is only for one thing. Like the last psukim, the last pasuk in Parshas Vaheschanon, Ayoim la'asoysom. Ayoim la'asoysom. This is only to do. Umachor. The endless machor is l'chabal schorom. Let us forgo meeting in this world everything, like the Mesillas Yesharim says. Ridifa satanugim, running after the goodies of life, the heshlem kol tenoeyim, but every little detail. Something new came out somewhere in Japan, I must have it. And if it came out in Turkey, I must have it. And if it came out in Singapore, I must have it. And if Chas V'Shalom it came out somewhere, Oylam Hazeh, how could I live and leave anything behind? But if we get if an awareness and a maturity grows on us, that Oylam Hazeh wasn't created to utilize it to the nth degree for Gashmias, but to use it as a springboard for everlasting neshama existence, we would look at a lot of issues, whether it's ben adam l'chaveroi and ben adam l'makom, much more profoundly, much more meaningfully. So l'zdei b'shehelfin, shelo yishama shoy b'sheva oy b'gulenu. This should be bilo amaves l'netzach. And we should be zoiche to be worthy, bekoroiv, of the geula shleim of b'mehar yameinu.
The Rashi Yeshiva, the Rabbanim, the Menalim, the Medrash says in the opening to Eicha. Ilu zechisem, hayisem, koyrim b'toyra leil shmurim hu la Hashem. Va'achshav shaloi zechisem, harei atem koyrim bochoi sifke balaylo. The Medrash tells us that every calamity that befalls us has to do with Klal Yisrael being zoichem. We could have been zoicha that a chasn and kala is a mayid, and that Pesach is its full mayid. We weren't zoicha. We could be zoicha in Pashas Vayikra, Eish Tamid Tukad al Mizbeach, and we got a pasuk from Eicha. We could have been zeicher that that evening would have been part of Pesach, a Leil Shemurim, and it became a Leil Tisha B'Av. It has to do with being zeicher. It has nothing to do with the mishpachas. As a matter of fact, I'm reminding myself of another medrash in Eicha, where a brother and a sister find themselves in an impossible situation. The brother says they didn't know who they were. They had been forced into a matzav. Each one said, I have a yichus, ani kohen ben kohen gadol. And she said, ani kohenes bas kohen gadol. And when they realized who they were, go'u bebechia gedola, atsha mesu, v'alehen haye yimiyah mekainen aleila ani bechia. If this wouldn't be Chodesh Nissan, today would be Yom Kippur Katan. There's a halacha on Yom Kippur that a person should think about and be mitztaya and be moired d'mo'ois on the Misas B'nai Aaron. It's part of Yom Kippur. And if it's part of Yom Kippur, then it's part of Yom Kippur Katan. And if it wouldn't be Chodesh Nissan, in which you can't be guys at Tainas, there would be Yom Kippur Katan today. This incredible asifa of the finest of the fine. This incredible asifa is to be ma'ira us that there's a Mises B'nai Aaron in our midst. Rabbi Zalman Meltzer, was the Rosh Yeshiva in Eretz Yisrael of Eitz Chaim. And his enikel, Rab Shneya Kotler, learned by him. But he had to go back to America. He had to go back to America to get married. He was a chassan. Rabbi Yankiv Zalaznik noticed, he was a close Talmud of Rabbi Zalman, that Rabbi Zalman used to walk Talmidim all the way down a long flight of stairs that was in front of his house. When Rabbi Shneya left, not Stam left, he's an Einikel. He left his Zayda to go to America to get married. If you walk a Talmud down, how far do you walk your grandson? And he noticed that he only walked him two steps. He went down two steps of the long flight of stairs. Rabbi Zalman, after Rabbi Shneya left, noticed that Rabbi Yankiv Zalaznik was perplexed. He says, I see you have a kasha on me. Ask me your kasha. And he said, after Lashon Decheretz, Rabbi, I don't understand. Everybody else you walked. And now all of a sudden, so he said, there's a big difference. My enikel is a chassan. How many of his friends, it was Tavshin Vav, 1946. How many of his friends are chassanim? Most of his friends just perished in the war. They will not walk down to a chuppah. They will not have a zayda hug them. Out of feeling and concern for those chassanim that can't walk down to their chuppas and have no one to walk them down, I am not going to indulge myself in my full ahava to my einikel because it's a shtikel zeichel l'churban. Binyamin had 10 sons. One of his sons was called Chupim. Zogin Chazal, why was he called Chupim? Because Binyamin said, I have a brother, and my brother, Chupim shuhu loy ra'a b'chupasi, v'ani loy ra'isi b'chupasai. What's that in the Chazal? What's in Rabbi Zalman's story? It's Someone told me he was in Panovich when a horrible accident took place. I was in Eretz Yisrael at the time. I was learning in yeshiva. And a bacha came lost. And four of his friends went to look for him. And they went to search. Rachman al-Islan, they wound up in a horrible car crash. All four were lost. The Olam HaTorah then, this is a Maisa of, I believe, 46 years ago. The Olam HaTorah was Nizdazeya. Someone told me, he learned in Panovich at the time. I was in Yerushalayim. He told me this story. That the Bachrim couldn't learn. Nobody could learn. How could they learn? They stood around second Seder, and they were just stunned and talking. And Rav Shach came in, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, and sat down by his shtanda and learned. The next day again, and the next day again. The third day that Rav Shach came in, they saw he was dragging his feet, and he looked terribly pale. So one of the Bachrim walked over to help him, and he asked him if the Rosh Yeshiva is not feeling well. And Rav Shach burst into tears, and he said, "Ich fühle sich nicht gut. Wie kann ich sich gut fühlen? How could I feel good? Ich schlaf schon nicht kaffee nacht. I haven't slept for 4 nights. 4 nights. Four Bachrim, four boys were killed. How could I sleep?" And this Bacha said to me, then I understood who the Rosh Yeshiva was. For the last 3 days, he was learning during Second Seder. And we weren't. Four boys were killed. The Rosh Yeshiva was able to learn, but he couldn't sleep. We were able to sleep, but we couldn't learn. And then we understood the difference between our Adam Gadol and who we are. Rabbi Zalman, Chupim, Rav Shach can't sleep. Rabbi Isai, we live in a time of instant news, and we live in a time of untold tragedies. In this community that saw the patira of 7 members of a family, this year a few members of another family, and some lahavdil ben chayim lachayim that are still struggling for a refuah, and now this. And there's a tremendous danger. The danger is that we become numb. The Chibina Rav Zecher Tzadik Livracha used to say, "Wie kann Simcha herrschen bei mir in Stub, or beim Schuster ist das Kind never krank?" How could I have joy in my house? The shoemaker's child is not well. We have long lists of tilim because we network. In every town, there used to be 2 people who were sick, and there was 1 levi in 6 months. But we live in a big metropolis, and even if we don't live in a big metropolis, we're connected. Everything happens in Eretz Yisrael, everything happens in another city. We're all connected. And all the bad news accumulates. And we're only human. We get numb. And chalil of a chas to become numb. Rab Chaninya ben Tradian was burnt alive with his Sefer Torah. And the question was asked, "Rebbe, ma atoraya?" The Talmidim asked him, "What do you see?" It says Tosfos in Avodah Zarah. How did they know he saw something? They said, "You had to see something. A human being wrapped in a Sefer Torah is burned to death. Ma atoraya? What do you see?" Maybe he sees a malach, Tosfos said. Maybe see something else, but there has to be something. It can't just be news. It can't be news. You know what we've become? Somebody's holding a telephone and he's scrolling news. Oh, wow. Terrible. Two people burnt to death. And we keep scrolling to the next piece of news. We're becoming numb. And we can't afford to. It's not our fault. But we're not zoiche. Ilu zechisem. We're not zoiche. Rabbi Sayyid, Rav Rudni Shlita, Mundus. If I could be a little bit more specific. Rashi says on the Pasuk, Vayinochem. What do you mean the Eibishter had Nechama? The Eibishter, Kaviyachal, changed his mind? Rashi says that all Lashon Nechama in the Torah is a Lashon of Nehepach, Nimlach. It means to rethink. The Panovich Rav says, somebody asked him, there's a minute that you go home from a Levaya, not the same way you came. You take a different road. Someone asked the Panovich Rav, what's the makka of the minig? And he answered simply, well, we came home gain the zelba. How could you go home the same way you came? Chaim Shmulevitz tells an incredible thing. Yeravim ben Navot is standing on a mizbeach, and a Navi comes and musses him, and he warns him what's going to happen. The mizbeach is going to split. And Yeravim stretches his hand out to grab the Navi, and the Pasuk says that his hand became paralyzed. He couldn't retract it. He couldn't move. So Yerav ben Nevat understood that the Navi is a Navi, and he has a koyach tefillah. So he says to the Navi, be mispalel that I should have a refuah. And the Navi was mispalel, and he had a refuah, and his hand began to move again. And the Pasuk says, Vatihi kibirishayna. It was like it once was. Says Rashi HaKadosh, Vahatihi kibrishayna doesn't go on the hand, it goes on Yeravam. He went back and he was oimid umaktir. He went and did the exact same thing he did before he was paralyzed. What's with you? You were warned by a Navi, you tried to strike a Navi, you became paralyzed. Where more do you need a simon min hashamayim? You asked the Navi to be mispalel. He was mispalel. You got a refuah. You can't say it came from a doctor. It came from somewhere else. You just witnessed it. Vatihi kibirishayna, says Rab Chaim Shmulevitz. Es hat ihm nicht angerührt. That's Yeravam. You could see it with your own eyes. Rabbi Brudny tried to tell us, Rabbi Isai, this is not normal. It's not normal. And you have to care. There's an incredible medrash. At the time of the burning of the Beis HaMikdash HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if it wouldn't be a chazal, we wouldn't be allowed to say it. Ba'ois ha'shoa nichnusu oivim laheichol v'sofua ba'esh kiven shenisraf oma HaKadosh Baruch Hu shuv ein li moishav ba'aretz. I don't have a place left. Amar lahem HaKadosh Baruch Hu l'malachei Yesharos boyu v'nei lechani v'atem v'nira ma osu ha'oivim. Let's go together and see the destruction that was done by our enemies. Miyad halach HaKadosh Baruch Hu l'malachei Yesharos v'yim yo lefonov. Kiven shara beis ha-migdash ha-mavadai zeh hoya beisi v'zeh hoya minuchasi shabohu ha-oivim sham v'osu kiritzoynim v'oysa shah yitzayik u'boicha. HaKadosh Baruch Hu began to weep. Va'omer, Bonai Heichonheim, where are my sons? Koyanai, Vilavi'ai, Heichonheim. Adirai, my Talmid HaChachamim, Heichonheim. Umer Esa, Kama Pa'amim Misreisi Bechem, Shetachzeru B'tshuva, V'lo Yasisim. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu L'Yimia. Rabbi Sayyid, if it wouldn't be a chazal, no one would be dare say this. HaKadosh Baruch Hu dismisses Yirmiyah and says, bring me Avram, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. I need more than you. He says, Ma'ata roya b'doimem. Hayoim ani doime la'odam shahoyeloi ben. I'm like a father. Va'osa oisoi chupa. And I made a chupa for him. Umeis b'toi chupasai. Ve'ein l'cho ke'ev loy alai v'loy al b'ni. The Eibishter is telling Klal Yisrael through Yirmiyah, I just lost my son in his chuppah. Do you care enough? I know who cares. Avram Yitzchak v'Yaakov, bring them here. It's a medrash. Rabbi said, we have to care. If I may, I want to tell you a story that I had. One day in shul, I get a phone call. There's a mace mitzvah on Coney Island Avenue. Not far from here, there's a funeral parlor. A man who was left in a morgue for 2 weeks in Florida, no one was able to identify him. Now they identified him, and New York state law says he has to be buried from the same chapel and in the same funeral parlor and with the same casket that his father had. And the state pays for it. So that's how he wound up over here. Maybe you have a minion so we can make a Leviathan. So I, with five or six other people from shul, went to this Leviathan of a person whose name we didn't know. Rabbi said, I have to tell you something incredible happened at that Leviathan. I even had to be maspid. Someone I don't know his name. No one spoke by that Leviah to each other. Everyone walked around. Everyone walked around like numb. And I was trying to figure out, I've been by Leviahs. Unfortunately, I see people on their phones. I see people whispering to each other, talking during Hespedim. Why not at this Leviah? Adarabba. Nobody knows who he is. And I said to myself, I think I know the reason. By every Leviah, someone has a reason to be there. I knew him. I live on the block. We're related. And you also have something else to say maybe about that person that maybe you shouldn't say or think. But this person, you only came for one reason to his Leviah. He's a Tzelem Elokim. He has no other identity. There's nothing else to him. But he's a Tzelem Elokim, and that's why he has to be buried. And for a Tzelem Elokim, a pure Tzelem Elokim, everybody had their heritage. So what's the chesaron of the next yid? Rabbi, it's Svira. Some of you are already in Minhage Avelis and some will be next week. And why? There are two chazal. Your rabbeim tell you one for sure, shaloi nohagu kovet zeh b'zeh, the gemara in Yevamos. But there's another chazal, a medrash in Keheles. Shehoya einehem sorosam zeh b'zeh b'toira. You didn't fagin the next person, his kasha or his teretz or his pshat, and you argued with him and put him down. That's what it says in Keheles. And when Rabbi Akiva rebuilt his yeshiva, he turned to his new talmidim and said, don't do what the others did. We were machar of a world that way. Putting other people down. I stood at that Leviathan and I said, there's a Tzelem Elokim. People recognize a Tzelem Elokim. The only trouble is that we know the Tzelem Elokim. And he's wearing a suit. And we had experiences with him. But that doesn't take away from his Tzelem Elokim. Adrabba. But we're not like that. Adam Yireleh Naim, V'Hashem Yireleh Levav. Perhaps if we could start once again to feel for someone else. Rabbi Brudny was talking about our running to satisfy and gratify every appetite. Where does that come from? It comes from thinking about someone else. I don't know if there are bachrim here from Tveris Elimelech, but there's a great Rebbe in Tveris Elimelech, Rav Herschel Zayin Gesund, who when my son was in his class, he suddenly stopped him as he was walking into yeshiva with his briefcase. Next is Chavrusa, who was carrying a briefcase, and suddenly, inexplicably, he says to them, "Switch." "Switch? Yeah, you take his, you take his." They kept walking and smiling to each other. It was a funny thing for the Rebbe to do. And then he explained, when you're schlepping your briefcase, you're doing nothing for the world. You're doing something for yourself. You schlep Yenim's pekel, you're doing something for him and for the rest of Klal Yisrael. Switch peklach. Turn that act of carrying into a mitzvah. Elevate it. Be mechabed another tzelem elikim. Rabbi, the Mises Bnei Aharon, it says by Elazar v'Asama, it also says, Banav Hanoisarim, says Rachi, the remaining children, it shouldn't have said Noisarim, it should have said Nisharim. What's Noisa? Noisa is a part of a carbon that was supposed to be burnt and wasn't. Rashi zogt, Banav Hanoisarim en Kulam Hoyu B'Gezeira. Was there a Gezeira just on 11 Mishpacha and a Kaplan Mishpacha? Cholila B'Chas. B'Krabai HaKadosh. HaKadosh Baruch Hu took the best. For the carbon that Rabbi Brudny spoke about, the Rashbam says that the fire that struck Nadav Avihu was the same fire that struck the carbon. It went around. First it struck them and then it went to the Mizbeach, which means they are part of the Mizbeach. And we're the Banav HaNoisarim, which means the Gezeirah could have been on me and you exactly the same way. Every single one of us walked out of that car and survived the car. Not we're remote. I'm in Brooklyn. That is a far Rockaway. We're all in that car. We made it out. What did we make it out for? Why were we zeiche? They were zeiche, like Rabbi Brudny said, to have an erison of l'chaye oilam above netzach netzachim. We still are given the pathway through this world to the next one. Why were we saved? My Rabbi say, if we don't walk this extraordinary kinnis of the pe'erim of our community, or our Bnei Torah, our Yeshiva Bachar, and you are the people who could understand this. This is not news. This is not statistics. Like Rabbi Chanan writes, there are car accidents all over the world. Rabbi Chanan says, why is there tzaras in the world if there's only, he brings a medrash by Yikra, there's tzaras. The whole world thinks it has leprosy that's similar to tzaras and symptoms. He says, not to embarrass us, but tzaras is only for us. And guess what? So Klal Yisrael turns around and says, oh, everybody gets tzaras. It's not just for Lashon Hara and us. So we continue our ways. So the Eibishter says, I have to give you a double portion. And that's Nachmu, Nachmu Ami, says Rabbi Chanan. Lokcha b'kiflayim. We get doubles. If someone walks away and says, this is a car accident, and this is a statistic, he wasted his time at this asifa. This asifa is a asifa of his oiris and chizuk to let us know the Eibishter treats us different, and sometimes it's harsh, but we're his people. It's a strange way, but the Tiferes Shleima, the Radomska writes, and some of you have learned this Gemara, Mashcheini Achrecha Nerutza, Shmuley Mamelech says, Mashcheini Achrecha Nerutza. In fact, the Tver Shleima, if the Eibishter draws us to him, Why do you have to say, I will run after you? I'm being drawn. Says the Tver Shleima, those of you who have learned the Gemara Bava Metzia and Bava Kama know that there's two ways to do Mashiach. You could do Mashiach by taking something, where you take a behema and it's oika, it's regel, from one makam to the other, and you pulled it. That's Mashiach. There's another one. Hikisha b'makel. If you go ahead and you give the animal a patch, and the animal runs, and it was oika yad v'regel. How could he tell the difference between the two Mashiachs? Says the Tver Shleima, if you're walking ahead, it's Mashcheini. But if it's Hikisha b'makel, then the Balabas walks from behind and patches. Mashcheini Eibishta, give us a Mashiacha, bring us close to you. Aber in a oifen of Achrecha Nerutza, when we run after you and not you walk behind us with a stick. Rabbi, this was a stick. We weren't zoiche to the other Mashcheini. But it's a Mashcheini of sorts. Our job is to turn this Mashcheini into the other Mashcheini. To treat the bacha sitting next to you as a tzelem elikim, not just the guy who sits next to me. Another guy in the class. Oh, he asks that kasha again. Someone asked a good kasha. Someone said a vart and you feel bad that you didn't ask it. Don't undercut his feet. Rabitzel Petterburg says you could be taller than your friend in two ways. You could climb a ladder above him or you could build a bar under his feet. There are two ways to be taller, which is the way the Torah wants. Grow. Get on a ladder. But don't hack him unto the feast. He's a tzelem elikim. We're all together here because a tzelem elikim that was supposed to become two, that was supposed to become one, are having their chuppah elsewhere. And their heilig appearance, I have never been by such a nicham abelim in my life. In both families. It's not shaykh. They understand Mashiach. Ooh, could they say a shir Mashiach? Rabbi say, no one can allow himself to walk here, leave this place the way he came. Vayinochem, nimlach, ha'andra machshava. Vatehi kibur reshoina chalila. We can never be the same. And that's chus from the zayche zayin. So achrecha nerutza.
We're just waiting 2-3 minutes until the Levin Mishpucha finishes davening mincha, and then Yisrael's father is going to speak and say a few words to us. I just want to share a story that Yisrael's mother told me the other night when I went to be Menachem Uvo. And it's a story that speaks to me, it speaks to everyone, and it's a story that we can walk out of this asifa with something very tangible. In addition to what we heard from the Rebunim and the Rosh Yeshivas, Mrs. Levin told me that a bucha came over to her, told her, I owe your son Yisroel a tremendous akuras hatoiv. And she said, how so? And the bucha says, he taught me how to daven. This was a 17, 18, 19-year-old bucha. He taught me how to daven. And the bucha says that he was struggling with davening. Didn't speak to him. Came into Beis Medrash, and this is a chush of a bucha. This is a bucha ben Torah. He says, davening, I found it like mitzvahs anushim elamudim ba, shachris, mincha, mariv, until Yisrael told me, why don't you do what I do? He says, when I put on tefillin in the morning, I close my eyes for a moment, and I picture myself standing in a long corridor. Very long corridor, he says. No windows, no doors, no distractions whatsoever. And I start davening, I'm walking down the corridor. I don't remember if he said there's little arches and niches. This one is Baruch Sheoma. I get to the next one is Ashrei. And I'm trying very hard to stay focused, as we call tunnel vision. I'm not looking miyamini, I'm a smiley, I'm looking straight ahead. This corridor has no windows and doors, there's nothing happening. It's me walking down a path and I am davening. Comes Yishtabach, Birchas Yoitze, then comes Krishma. He says, when I come to Krishma, I imagine that I am standing in front of two huge gates. I'm going to be Mekabel Ol Malchus Shemayim. And then as I say, Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, I cover my eyes. I picture that these doors are opening up and I am walking into the Paltrin Shel Melech. And when I say Gual Yisrael, I picture myself standing at the end of the corridor in front of the Melech Malchem Lucham HaKudosh Baruch Hu. For those of you that are sitting here that knew Yisrael, this is how he davened. But this is what he told the Bucha a while ago. Bucharim, if we could walk out of here with the message, in addition to what we heard from the Gedolei Yisrael, the message from this Heilige Nifter, I am sure this will be a tremendous aliyah for his neshama. And it would help us, as it would help myself. With Kavuna Satfila. Epshaya.
Highly unusual for an Ogle to speak to such a proud reason. But the purpose of my speech now, and I'll tell you up front, because I know you've had a lot of patience since 6 o'clock and it's getting late, and I have a lot of people waiting to see me. But the purpose of my remarks to you is because I want to be Ba'iris Chusim for my two hafseidim, Yisrael and Elisheva. If Yisrael would be here now, and we see such a chashuva olam b'nei Torah, his initial reaction would be, say to all of you, I love you. This was his trademark. And he had no problem saying that to everybody and anybody, including his rabbeim. Let me tell you a little about Yisrael, so you can have a little idea of who the great Nifter was. Yisrael had learned in the Beretzky Yeshiva from elementary, under the Chashev Rosh Yeshiva Rosh Olam Noach. From there he went to Masifta, to the wonderful Kamenetz Masifta. From there he went to Beis Medrash at Darchei Torah. After Darchei Torah, he went for a year to Mir Yerushalayim. Yisrael, at the age of 20, unfortunately lost his older brother, Ari. And it made a tremendous roshim on him. A roshim that would change his life mamish. Yisrael felt very bad at the patira of his older brother, Ari. Ari was 26 at the time of his patira, and Yisrael was 20. And Yisrael felt that in as much as Ari had expressed a lot of ahava to Yisrael, Yisrael felt he had not expressed adequate ahava back to Ari. That bothered him, and it hurt him. I tried to console him and tell him to be realistic. Ari, 6 years older than you, there was two girls between you. It's not normal to expect that you have such a tight relationship with a brother who's that many years older than you in that type of situation. But he wouldn't take my excuses, and he felt very bad, and he resolved at that point that he's going to have a kesher with his brother Ari, even though Ari was not alive anymore. Now, how do you do that? Last year, on Chof Shvat, we went to Eretz Yisrael on the first yard site of Ari to do a Hakamas Matseva, and we spent the week in Eretz Yisrael. During that time, Yisrael went to visit his chaverim in Mir Yerushalayim, his chaverim from Darkei Torah, and he got bitten by the bug. On the way back on the plane, he told his mother, "Ma, I'm going to learn after Pesach in Mir Yerushalayim." His mother said, "It's time for that. You're young, you're 20. You can do it in a year from now. Why don't you go back to Darkei Torah?" And he said, "Ma, I'm going to Mir Yerushalayim." So after Pesach, Yitaka went to Mir Yerushalayim. Every Friday, well, let's put it this way, very frequently, he would go to the Beis Olam Beis Shemesh, where Ari was buried, and he would spend time with his brother. And he would bond with his brother. We have pictures of him hugging Ari's matzeva. This was the only way he could mamish hug him now that Ari was no longer here. Anyone who knew Yisrael knew that Yisrael would hug people who he loved, so all he could do now was hug his matzeva. And Yisrael would talk to his brother Ari, and he would say to him that, "Ari, I know that you're in Shemayim, and you're looking down, and you're watching over Tati and Mami, you're watching over the whole Mishpacha, you're watching over me, and you're piling Zachen upstairs, the family. And I want to let you know that I, down here, I'm doing things for you too. I'm learning, I'm doing mitzvahs, trying to do for you as much as I possibly can, because I miss you and love you so much." In the summertime, Yisrael came back to America, because he was always a counselor in Camp Agudah. And he would inculcate his campers with tremendous hashkofis. Yisrael was a very, very warm, affectionate, loving person who genuinely loved everyone in Klal Yisrael. He had what's called uninhibited love. What does uninhibited love mean? He would be able to go over to Rebbe and hug the Rebbe and tell him, "I love you," and he wouldn't be embarrassed. And the Rebbe, I asked the Rebbe, "How did you react to that?" And the Rebbe said, "I liked it very much." Yisrael would give her lessons in Be'er Tefillah to his campers at night before they go to sleep. He would use pathway to prayer, and he would teach them all the kavanas and davening, Shmoneh Esrei. All the other bunks, you walk past the other bunks at night, you hear noise going on. But when you go past Yisrael's bunk, hear perfect quiet, except Yisrael teaching the Be'er Tefillah. Now you might think, listen, summer in camp, are the boys really absorbing this? Maybe it's sleeping, they're just having their hair spin, but they're not, you know, they're not absorbing, they're not listening. Later on, Yisrael will call all the members of the Anhol of the camp, and he'll tell the boys, "Tell Rabbi so-and-so what the Kavanah in Baruch Aleinu is. Tell them what the Kavanah is in Rebbe's Ovis." The Imam Shechab the Spilus, boys mamish knew Be'er Tefillah. Also, he would, we just found out now, some boys who came to Nach Mopel, they wrote up a little kuntris of all the shiurim Be'er Tefillah Yisrael gave to them. I said, "I don't understand. Did they write it down B'Shas Ma'isa in the summer? Did they tape record it?" I said, "No. They're doing it from memory." They had such a Yisrael has such a hashpa on them, they were koilet, everything he taught them, that they mamash remember till today. It's 3/4 of a year, come on, after last summer. It shows you the tremendous influence he had on these boys. Now, typically, when a mother sends, and a typical, let's put this in, a typical bunk camp, let's say there's 20 boys. 2 to 4 of them, the reason why they're in camp is because the mother wants them to gain social skills that they're lacking during the school year. They don't feel part of the oilam, they're a little shy, could be a little bashful. Yisrael would take these boys under his wing, build up the confidence, encourage them, and by the time the summer's finished, mamash be new people. Go back to school, mamash like an equal shava b'shava with anyone else. The boys, the counselors at camp, would give vadim at different times. Mikey Rabinowitz would have a group of 30, Aaron Hertzberg would have a group of 40, Yisrael Levin had a group of 30, and they'd give hashkafa to the boys. When the word would go out that Yisrael Levin was talking about his brother Ari, all 100 chevra would come flocking to Yisrael because they wanted to hear what he had to say and they knew it was going to be something special. Now, here it's very interesting. Yisrael would give them hashkafa shir, would tell them like this, it's not true that you are here, you know, Camp Agud in the summer to have a good time. And you're entitled to it. All year you learn Torah. You work very hard. In the summer we got to let off a little steam. So we're here in Camp Agud, Ruach country, to have a good time in a Torah-dika atmosphere. We have Rabelski Zichrono Livracha around us. We see Gedolim. We know we're Mugdar and we're having fun in the Kashra Oifen. But I want to let you know something else also, that we have to start preparing ourselves. I had an older brother, Ari, who passed away at the age of 26 suddenly, and I realized that you never know when your time is up, and therefore, we have to start working on ourselves, to improve ourselves, to be misakin ourselves. This is what he would tell 14-year-old boys, and the boys would be makabel. Because it's one thing if you have a 45, 50-year-old adult telling a young boy something like that, he would say, ah, this is an old man talking. You saw Yisrael Levin, 20 years old, contemporary, telling them something like this, they realized that it's emes, and they were makabel. How do I know this? Because they're telling this to be b'shiva. So, it had a tremendous influence on all the boys. Yisrael was very well known for his kavana in davening. He would daven a long Shmoneh Esrei, an Erlich Shmoneh Esrei, with kavonis, sometimes with tears. He would be davening like this in Darkei, and the boys would look at him at the end. He was like the last guy to finish. They saw how sincere his Shmoneh Esrei was. But you could say, listen, that's all fine and dandy if you're in the Dalet Amos of the Beis Medrash, during the yeshiva year, in the right environment. So it brings out the Kedusha in you. But the real test, when you go out of the yeshiva, when you go on vacation in the summer, you go to camp, and there's always activities to do, right? If the mincha, boating, swimming, playing, sports, whatever. Over there, he still davened the same exact Shmoneh Esrei that he did in yeshiva. And the campers and the staff and the boys would see that, he made a very big roshim. Yisrael is a solid ben Torah. His hashkafis are solid. Doesn't make a difference where he is. If he's in Yeshiva Dalet Amos, if he's in camp, a Ben Torah is a Ben Torah. Can you have fun? Yes, yeah, you can have fun. Can you be normal? Yes, you can be normal. But everything has to be done with Hashkaf of Torah. I feel that he was mamish mashlim himself, and he was oivid on himself. He worked on various different inyanim, which brought him to his hashlama, because gufa, because of the hashpah he had from the mitzvah of his older brother. That's what inspired him and motivated him to work on himself and to become the gavra rabba that he was. One of the boys sitting over there at Shiva told me the story, and he said that you should know that Yisrael always would talk about his father, that his father was his role model. I said back to him, Listen to me very well, because you're a young fellow, and carry this with you for the rest of your life. After all these maisim that I'm hearing about Yisrael from you and all the other boys, Yisrael is my role model. So they looked at me. I said, very partial. He said, I am betuach that be'ez Hashem Yisbarach, I'm going to live a long, happy, and healthy life. And I have lots of time to fix up what I got to fix up. I know my inyanim. I know what I still have to do to fix myself up. And I'm the type of person, I don't like to work good under pressure. So I'm going to take my sweet time. That was my attitude till now in life. Yisrael, at the young age of 20, at Feshtan and the Chazal say, Shuv, Yoim, Echad, Choydem, Yisoscho, do tshuva one day before you die. Well, how can you do that? Obviously, that means that you do tshuva every day, because you never know when's your final day. So he put that into practice, and he started to work on himself and to polish himself up. And Mimela, because he internalized this, he was able to go to camp and give it over to the Bachrim, the Emes, that it should have a lasting hashpah on them. So the reason I'm telling this to you is because for Eiz Hashem, you're starting a new zman. All Bnei Torah are starting a new zman, spring, summer zman. And this is a wonderful opportunity to understand that not only am I going to push my efforts to steig in learning, in lomdis, in midas, in tefillah, in musar, and all the other inyanim, but underlying that, there should be the same concept that the 14 and a half year old boys in Camp Aguda took to heart also. We gotta do this with a seriousness. We gotta motivate ourselves to keep in mind that I really gotta hop around while I'm young, because nobody knows what the target date is. And it'll make a big, big nafkamina in your shrushim, the binyan of what you're trying to build on yourself now, in your foundation. You go with that attitude. I saw that slacha that Yisrael had. If you're emistic makabel, that time is valuable. I can't push off to later what I could do today. It'll change your whole cook. You will steig much, much more. You'll accomplish much, much more. You'll be serious more. Again, Yisrael was a fun guy. If you ask anybody, he was a very funny guy. He was a geschmacka guy. Like I said, he used to hug you and grab you with an emes. He made everyone happy, besimcha. He would spread the happiness around. He gave kares to everyone. Not a stira to someone in his seichel and his mayach and his heart knows, underlying everything, I got to work on myself also. I got to accomplish. I got to make a gavra out of myself. Everything he did, he would confer with his rabbeim. It was very interesting. We heard in our shiva that after he left Veretsky and he moved on to Kamenetz, every bein asmanim, he would come back to Veretsky and he would circulate to all his rabbeim. You can ask them, speak to them tomorrow, ask them if that's not true. He would keep a kesher with all his rabbeim. When he went from Kamenetz to Darkei Torah, he would come back to Kamenetz and circulate, keep in touch with Zerbeim, and then go to Veretsky and keep in touch with them. He was always Mekusha with Das Torah. Any major thing, or maybe even minor thing, but for sure every major decision he had to make, he would confer with his Rabbeim so he could hear Das Torah, and he was Makabel Das Torah. That's a key to Hatzlacha as well. I just want to be Messiah. So I'm under a lot of time pressure. I just want to be Messiah to wish everybody here tremendous, tremendous haslach in the new zman. And I want to ask a personal bakasha on behalf of my Yisrael and Yishayahu Alevi and also Elisheva Basia and Ephraim and Yechiel Ephraim. Yechiel Ephraim. If everybody would please learn Le'iloi Nishmasam and send up the schus of Torah to them in Gan Eden, where they're counting on us now. They're going to pile Zech and Shemayim on their end. But they need, we each send Pekelech up to them. And you learn Torah and have them in Zinn, and say, I'm learning Le'ilin Neshmasim. They were such Tamimim Tahirim. They obviously reached their Hashlama in this world because the Rebbeinu Shalom would not have taken them if it went to reach that Shlomo. So they were Mushlim. They need our help. And Rav David Feinstein, just one Messiah, that Rav David Feinstein was at the Kaplan house, and he told the Kaplans that the famous Pasuk Shir Shirim, the Rebbeinu Shalom comes down, Lilkoy the Bashashadim, to gather in the roses. What's Pshat roses? The Rebbeinu Shalom upstairs wanted a bouquet of flowers. Who did he choose from the Ganze Welt to take as his bouquet? Yisrael and Elisheva. So I want to again wish you tremendous hatzlacha bracha, and please, everything that you do, learn le'ilei nishmasam that they should have zchusim. Yashar koach.
Noi chofeis loman zidko yagdil toy rovi adir yizkadal li yizkada shishemei rabo ve'omod ivroch irusei ve'amlich malchusei ve'atzmach burkone ve'korev mishichei v'chayei choynu v'yoymei choynu v'chayei lechol beis Yisroel v'agolo v'izman koriv v'imru omein yehei shmei rabo mevorach l'olam ol'olmei ol'mayo yisporach v'ishtabach v'ispohar v'yisroimam v'yisnasei Viz hador, viz ale, viz halol, shmei dekutsho brichu. Leilo min kol b'chosso, v'shiroso, tush b'chosso, v'nechem oso. Damiron b'olmo, v'imru omein. Yehei shlomo rabo min shemayo, v'chayim toivim oleinu. V'al kol Yisroel, v'imru omein. Oysa shalom b'imroimo, v'yasa shalom oleinu, v'al kol Yisroel, v'imru omein.